This is Ham Radio Now, episode 397. Is this going to work live? No. Oh, I pushed the wrong button. Make that go away. Go away. Go away. This is Ham Radio Now, episode 397. Let's see if I can do this one right. Oh, yes, it sort of worked. But that time it didn't. I have no idea. I have no idea how to run this ship. There we go. 397 Jamboree. Ham Radio Now is the... Wait a minute. What are you trying... Are you trying to give me a clapboard? Get things in sync?
I am.
Go ahead. Do that again. Yeah. Yay.
Yeah, we don't ever reshoot anything here.
It's bad when I lose control of the program before I even started it.
Exactly. One take.
All right. So Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. Do I have any idea where this is? I think it's there. There.
Not that one.
Yeah.
That one.
Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. You know what to do. HamRadioNow.tv. Click the pig. And now, make that go away. I'm still learning this title thing. And what button do I want to push to get all three of us? There we go. Woo-hoo. So I got... Our co-host, David Goldenberg on the West Coast. So hello, David. How are you doing?
Good evening. I'm doing well. David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
There's your title.
Here, but I got my fan going. And oh, look, I got titles.
Yeah, got a title for you. And our guest here in North Carolina, just down by the coast, waiting for the next hurricane to hit.
Thank you.
Is Bill Morine, N2COP, not... in law enforcement.
Not original issue call.
And do I get all that stuff right there? Can you see that title? Roanoke Division Vice Director?
Yes, I can. Okay. I can. Thank
cool.
you.
Yeah.
That's, we're good.
Oops. It's going to be a while before I learn how to do this title thing. And we're all here to play Jamboree. So the Boy Scout Jamboree is just wrapping up, right?
Thursday.
A couple more days.
Last day.
Yeah. Yep. And how long did you spend out there?
Me?
Yeah.
Yesterday.
I didn't go, and David didn't go.
it was astounding. I had set it up that I would do a one-day visit on behalf of ARRL yesterday, which was, I'm looking at the calendar here, Monday, July 24th, for those who are seeing this not live, maybe off-cycle, later replay. And over the weekend, it had been announced that President Trump was going to visit. At 7:45 a.m. Monday morning, I received a call from Jim Wilson, K5ND, who was the coordinator for K2BSA at the Jamboree, saying, well, he said, security's so tight, we have to wrap up operations for the day at K2BSA by 11 a.m., should we blow this whole thing off? And I said, no, I'm here. The West Virginia section manager, Dan Ringer, K8WV, is also here. Let's do it. So Dan and I hustled our bustle, got out, went through all the clearances, got onto the grounds at the Jamboree, quickly found K2BSA, enjoyed watching Scouts for about 20 minutes before operations ended to make arrangements for the president to arrive at the arena show. We stayed for about another hour, had a good meeting with the staff of K2BSA, wandered around a little bit, and then at 1 o'clock, magically, the United States Army and details from the Secret Service emerged, and we were politely told if we didn't have a ticket to attend the arena show that evening to see the president that all visitors needed to skedaddle, which we understood, and we skedaddled, and we were on a bus by about 1:30 p.m. and got off premises.
Okay, so you couldn't even hang around the station.
No, we saw just a quick snippet of how the station worked and the different operating positions. But to the credit of Jim Wilson and his team, what we saw compressed in that small time frame was very impressive.
And you've been there in previous years and got to stay longer, right?
Oh, yes. I was on staff at the National Jamboree in 2001 and 2005 when it was still located at Fort A.P. Hill outside of Fredericksburg, Virginia.
Okay, so you hadn't been to the Bechtel Summit, Reserve, whatever they call that.
Yeah, the Bechtel Summit Reserve. Yep, the summit. And yes, my first time. And if you haven't been, it is a treasure. And in so many dimensions, a marked improvement over the old Fort A.P. Hill location.
How many years have they been doing it now in West Virginia?
This is the second Jamboree.
Okay,
2013 was the first, and this is the second.
So they don't do it every year.
And that was the year they opened. Like 4 years ago was when they first opened the summit, or maybe the year before that.
Mm-hmm, right. And the summit will also be the host of the, and listen carefully to this, the World Jamboree hosting its North, with North America hosting it. And when I say North America, I mean the United States, Canada, and Mexico. But the World Jamboree in 2019 will also be at the summit.
What do they do there the rest of the year or the rest of 3.5 years?
It's now an open facility that's being developed. We learned that, and forgive me, I don't have these numbers in front of me, but I believe the second and third longest zip line courses in the world are now located at the summit. And it's available to other scouting units who wish to take advantage of the facilities.
Okay, I'm digging up a Google Maps of it. I should have done this before. So, David, take over the show.
Yeah, so I'll take over a little bit. So the Boy Scouts have, there's four what they call high adventure bases all across the USA. And I've been to Florida Sea Base. I haven't been able to go to Philmont or Bechtel or Northern Tier. Actually, I'm leaving tomorrow to go to Philmont for a couple days. My son's there right now. He's been there for 2 weeks, and he gets a couple days off, and then he's going back for another week. Bechtel, they opened, as Bill said, about 4 years ago, and I think the first big event that they had there was the last Jamboree, and it functions as a regular Boy Scout camp, but kind of on steroids, as you can see there.
Absolutely.
They have all the different activities that they have at the higher adventure base camps, you know, from zip line and shooting sports and white water rafting and kayaking, mountain climbing, lots of different stuff. I know that they put out a big call about a year ago to work the K2 BSA, and I had put in an application, but I couldn't work out the time to get away from work to make that work out. So I'm kind of jealous that you got to go out there and at least see it all.
You got to get rid of this phony baloney job. You can't go to Dayton. You can't go to Boy Scouts.
Yeah, I gotta win the lottery first.
So obviously the Google Maps thing is when nothing is going on, but is there a spot I want to be looking at here?
Oh yeah, actually, if you zoom out is probably what you want to do.
Okay. Yeah, it is. And to give your viewers an idea, from what I understand, the about 20% of the entire reservation has been developed, leaving 80% still undeveloped and still relative wilderness.
So a lot of this territory around here probably,
yeah,
right.
It's all just green.
Yes. Yep. If you move your cursor to the left, Gary, over to Route 19, you got to pull it over a little bit. That Route 19 is the main entrance in that town of Glen Jean. Whoops, go back up. And right there, boing, that is, and which is a tiny municipality, in Glen Jean is the Ruby Welcome Center, which is a very impressive stone building on Route 19 that is the official welcome center. From there, you park your vehicle and board a bus that will take you into the main Jamboree complex.
Okay, so nobody gets to drive in.
No, not into the main area, no. Well.
We pedestrians don't get to drive in. I'm sure there's some big shots to do.
It actually looked like the big facility is to on the other side of 19 from where you are. If you go right there, there's that Eagle's Nest camp. Yeah, that's probably where a lot of the action happens. Oh no, that's the National
This is National Guard, but who knows what that really means.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I guess I go a little wider out and there's Interstate 64 and 77. This is the route that I go by every year when I'm going to Dayton. So I pass nearby.
Yes. Now, the interesting thing, adjacent, the whole area where the Summit Bechtel Reserve is located is a very high adventure area, not just for Boy Scouts, but the surrounding area outside the reserve also has lots of whitewater rafting, zip lining, hiking, and outdoor activities. It's really the outdoor capital of West Virginia and that whole region. Which is perhaps best known for having the New River Gorge Bridge, which is now the third largest arch span bridge in the world. At one time, it was the first largest. And I believe it's every October, it's closed for one day to allow bungee jumping to the bottom of the gorge, which is some 700 feet below.
All right. And you were there to give an award. And I'm just looking at your Facebook page. A few of these pictures are part of it. The rest of it looks like family stuff.
For those of you who are in scouting, the one on the left, which is a bit of a fun, which was an eagle, somebody commented on my Facebook page, why is there a duck wearing a merit badge?
Oh, there's the duck, sash.
But it looks like a stunt duck.
It is an eagle.
It is an eagle.
Oh, yes, right. I got it.
It is.
But what's the deal for an eagle?
Oh,
Eagle Scout.
Eagle Scout.
Right. To the person who thought it was a duck, I cried foul.
Ouch.
Okay, so was this the picture of the award that you were handing out?
This is the award, and I made the award, or I went to present the award for two reasons. One was until this jamboree, ARRL, which has a Memorandum of Understanding, an MOU, with the Boy Scouts of America, which was entered into in 2011, or revised in 2011. ARRL had been represented directly by a staff member, Larry Wolfgang, WR1B. And Larry had been really great at being on premises the entire duration of the jamboree. Unfortunately, Larry left ARRL, and there was nobody from staff directly supporting the jamboree. Since it's located in West Virginia, which resides inside the Roanoke Division, I and Roanoke Director Dr. Jim Boner, N2ZZ of South Carolina, thought that because the jamboree is in our jurisdiction, it would be most appropriate that we step forward and show our appreciation for having K2BSA as a vital part of both the Roanoke Division and the section of West Virginia. And so the gentleman in the middle is Dan Ringer, KAWV, Kilowatt 8 Whiskey Victor. Nice call for West Virginia.
Who joined me in making
the presentation. And the gentleman on the right is Jim Wilson, K5MD, Kilowatt 5 November Delta, who is both the K2BSA and the Radio Merit Badge and JOTA coordinator on behalf of BSA, or Boy Scouts of America.
Yeah, we've had Jim on the show to talk about Boy Scouts and JOTA as well. He's a good guy.
He's a great guy.
What was the award that you guys presented him?
Just an award of appreciation from both the ARRL Roanoke Division and the West Virginia section. But although that's all it says on the award, it's also an appreciation from all of ARRL for advancing an amateur radio to youth.
Excellent.
All right. So the next things I want to know about are the Boy Scout amateur radio operation out there. So you've only had a chance to see a little bit of it.
I saw a little bit, but remember, my frame of reference was having been on the staff of K2BSA in 2001 and 2005. And I felt in my short visit yesterday that I had been on the launch rocket with Chewbacca into hyperspace.
So they got bigger.
It's gotten better. Rather than bigger, I think it's the same number of operating positions, 8, as there were at 2001 and 2005. The things that have improved have been just small infrastructure improvements, which make a vast difference. One was the old K2BSA operated out of a, we called it the circus tent. It was a red and white striped tent that looked like it belonged to Ringling Brothers, Barnum and Bailey, and its surplus department at that. So that's gone, and there's a very high ceiling area now. Remember, because it is a jamboree and is Boy Scouts, there is no such thing as air conditioning. There are fans running, but you're out there in the elements. The nicer thing was Fort A.P. Hill is located on the coastal plains of eastern Virginia. And so heat and humidity were the recipe at, continually at the previous jamborees. Now the new Bechtel Summit is in the mountains of West Virginia, and just the change in elevation automatically means lower temperatures, and that made it much more enjoyable. The other thing which those photos you have unfortunately don't convey is that K2BSA now is in a absolute fantastic location. It is near the main entrance and overlooks the main arena, the arena at which President Trump was present with 40,000 scouts on Monday, July 24th.
So can I see where that is on this? I'm not sure I could be able to tell.
I don't think I could tell either. Move to, if you move your cursor to the left, so we take, go to the right. No, other direction.
The other left.
Yeah, keep on going in that direction.
Yeah, maybe you can tell from where the water is.
I'm reorienting. Yes, okay, now.
Oh, okay, yeah, this looks like
okay,
it.
There.
Yeah. So yes, when you said that's the main entrance, but that it looks like okay, a long way from the highways, so it's kind of like the other
yes,
side.
Yes, but where the buses let you off. Here, let's look at that area. See, go okay, move it up, zoom out just a tad. Zoom out. Okay, at the bottom where it says the Jack First Drive, just about where your cursor is. Right now, Jack First Drive, that's where the buses come, and just at the curve or above your cursor is where buses pick up and drop off visitors from the main area out on Route 19 at the Ruby Welcome Center. And then that is the main entrance. Imagine, if you will, and again, Gary, move, if you can, the entire picture to the left so we can see more of that concrete complex. There we go. Good. You have a grand, just where it says Jack's Landing East at the bottom, there is a large, David, help me out here. We call it, what would you call it? Entrance, gateway, canopy, one of those ones through which scouts are often pass.
Oh, you mean like a fence portal or something like that?
Like a fence portal, correct.
Yeah, I don't know what you call it.
Right. And that's,
it's a gateway.
Now, zoom out just a little bit. Gary, move your cursor. See that patch of grass? See the word post office?
Yeah.
Okay, go up to post office. Now move your cursor slightly to the left, just a little bit more. That patch. Go back. Right there. Boom. Your cursor's right on that brown patch. That's where K2BSA is.
Oh, okay. Right there. All right. I'm going to widen out and let people get an idea. So is around here is where they set up the big stage and everything?
No, the stage is over to the left of the screen, right where it says Justine Plaza. It's down in that area. And where it says Legacy Retail Store and the, it's to the right of Brown Sea Island. The complex, the arena is where Legacy Retail Store is, those three white buildings that you see. That is the complex where the 40,000 scouts went to see the president.
Okay, so they're...
And you can see how close K2BSA is to where that arena is located.
Yeah, so the arena would be here and BSA is over here.
Yes, right. And...
Although, and this doesn't look like very far, but it's probably like a 20-minute walk.
Well, no, it is. It isn't. The scale is, that's really, and by the way, K2BSA is on a hill overlooking the arena, which is more at the same level as that lake.
Okay, it's 1,000 feet.
1,000 feet.
Okay, there's your field day circle.
There you go.
Yeah.
No, I said it's
Oh, Gary, 51 alpha from the Bechtel for the summit.
They were?
51
no,
alpha?
No. Can't you see that? That'd be your next video. 51 alpha from the summit.
Oh, well, I see that we didn't lose David. I just had you I'm still full here. Screen.
So you said a lot of improvements and advancements on the quality of the equipment and and the location. There is a lot of, I know ICOM's doing a lot with the Boy Scouts. Is a lot of ICOM equipment.
Absolutely, and the nice thing to see the operating positions. They had a the high-end one, 7,700, I think, was the high-end one. Two 9,100s, and the rest were ICOM 7,300s that were making up the eight positions that were there. The 9,100s were being used for satellite contact, and because of the poor state of HF propagation at this time, there was a great emphasis on satellite contacts and on digital modes. So these the satellites have been quite active there too. So, and for me, as somebody as alumnus of the previous K2BSAs in 2001, 2005, it was a joy to see, there's Bill Starnes.
And we are putting together the
K2BSA some of their Facebook video.
And we have the radios and computers getting set up right now. We're just going to take a walk in here.
So this is the setup time.
Operating divisions.
I think that's a 7,300 there.
Yeah, that was what it looks like. So they did really nice. They got headsets and stand microphones, PCs everywhere.
They do. And the other thing is, which has helped tremendously, David and Gary, is that this is the first Jamboree I can think of. Maybe this was true in 2013, that AT&T was a corporate sponsor, or is a corporate sponsor, for cellular activity and Wi-Fi. And despite the fact this is supposed to be scouting and really emphasis on outdoors, the reality is that both scouts and scouters, which is the term for adult scout leaders, want to remain in contact with the outside world. And to give K2BSA a tool that can really access the outside world is fantastic. If you've been following K2BSA on Facebook and Twitter, you know that they have been posting live their operating modes and frequencies so that people know where they are and how to get in touch. That's a vast difference from previous Jamborees.
Yeah, I had a number of boys from our troop go for the last Jamboree, and I don't remember them saying they made it out to the amateur radio stuff, but there were a lot of challenges that first year getting set up. There was a lot of weather and a lot of thunder and tornado warnings and stuff throughout the week.
Right.
But it looks like a great setup. What do they do? What do they do antenna-wise? So it looks like they had a lot of really good equipment on the inside there. There's the zip lines.
Yeah, the zip lines. Boy, doesn't that look fun? Oh, and that by the way, that zip line is adjacent to K2BSA.
Yeah, this is the same video. I just zoomed down the line a little bit.
Yeah.
Oh, that water filling station.
Yes, they have the water buffalo, those portable tanks, the camouflage that you see. But these were very convenient for filling water bottles.
So next year, I want them to invite me to teach people how to shoot video. Apparently, there is no video shooting merit badge.
So, well, you know, we'll do
I'm next getting year. Dizzy.
There's a movie making merit badge, Gary. But you know what? If you want to come, I'm supposed to go, and we haven't booked it 100% yet, but next year is Venture Fest. So the Venture Crew program is for the older and co-ed kids, scouts 14 to 21. And it looks like our Venture Crew, including probably my son and maybe my daughter, will be out there next summer. I think it's the 1st of July till the 8th of July. So pencil it in.
Okay.
It's worth the trip, Gary.
Yeah. And you can meet, W0IHG and November 6 Golf Mike Golf.
So I'm looking at the Facebook room. This is the videos that I see, and it doesn't look like there's like a real lot. First contact. Let's check that out.
Bravo 1 Victor Zulu Yankee. Thank you very much for the contact, and we'll put you in the lot.
Look at this street.
And we'll have information so that.
Looks like they kept the. Kept the sides of the tents rolled up to keep things cool.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, you need a cross breeze very much.
Till the thunderstorms come by.
Right, then you learn how to roll those down very quickly.
Did you get a sense of the RF background noise? So they have a pretty quiet RF location?
They do have a quiet RF location. The complex is fairly quiet overall, just by virtue of being out where it is. I don't know if there was a conscientious effort to make sure there was minimal RFI being generated, because, for example, the trading post, which is the Boy Scout term for Walmart, is right around the corner. Oh, believe me. And look, I know, please don't send me email or letters, but let's face it, one of the successful things, and rightly so, is that the Boy Scouts are excellent at merchandising. And their stores,
it's the Girl Scouts
right
that sell the cookies.
Oh, but the Boy Scouts know how to sell things. And they have an excellent trading post or store, which is about 100 yards from K2BSA. Well lit, lots of displays inside. I could not detect much RFI, if any.
Do they do solar power or anything like that?
No. But you were asking about the antennas, and I think sponsors.
Yeah.
The two major sponsors are ICOM and DX Engineering. And DX Engineering donated two hex beams, identical hex beams, which I think are 40 through 6, I think, or 20 through 6. I can't recall. And MFJ donated a dipole. They had a 6-meter beam out there. And then I don't know who the manufacturer is, but a directional array for satellite. Yeah, it is cool. And just great location overlooking at the top of the hill overlooking. Yeah, one of our eager students there, as you can see.
That's one of the great things about these high adventure bases, specifically for the amateur radio stuff, is typically they are kind of in the middle of nowhere, you know, in a forest or a nature setting. So there won't be.
Stop there, Gary, for a second. I'm sorry, David.
No, that's okay.
That is the view from the K2BSA tent looking out. Who would not like a view like that?
Yeah.
As you can see here, they're doing radio finding. I'm sorry, David. Please continue.
No, that's okay. You know, these locations are great for this if you can get everything set up, because there's not a lot of technology, you know. And in scouting, you know, we tell the scouts, you know, put your phones away. We're here for nature and the outdoors. And, yeah, we'll teach you something about radio and what you can do with that. But it does lend itself. I went to Florida Seabase 2 years ago, and I really struggled with, am I going to haul that Pelican case and that LiPo battery and a dipole for when they strand us out on the island for 48 hours and see if I couldn't work some DX down there. And I opted not to, but I kind of regret it. Go back to next time.
One thing, that balloon tracking is a great thing. Let me stop it there, if you wouldn't mind, please, Gary. But let me go on a side thing. I want to spend a moment talking about the philosophy of K2BSA at this Jamboree in 2017. I was talking with that signboard, by the way, is in the view line of K2BSA. So which you can see, SBR standing for Summit Bechtel Reserve. I want to talk about the philosophy of K2BSA this time around. I was very impressed with Jim Wilson, K5ND, as the head of the program, in saying that with high adventure all around and coupled with the capability, particularly for HF and for digital modes and low power, to be portable, that the philosophy this time around has been that not only can scouts come to K2BSA, but also that K2BSA goes to the scouts. Wrap your mind around that for a second. They are doing a lot of SOTA activities, S-O-T-A, Summits on the Air, where they are taking small QRP rigs and wire antennas and some verticals, and they are going to adjacent mountaintops. They are going to zip line locations. They're going to high adventure locations and bringing radio to the scouts. That is a dramatic departure of the traditional philosophy of telling all the scouts, you come to the tent. The tent now is going out to where the scouts is. And that has been, I think, a wonderful shift in paradigm as to how to expose amateur radio to youth.
So when something like that is going on, are they going someplace where the scouts are already doing other activities and then they're adding ham radio over to the side and saying, oh yeah, in addition, come take a look at this? Or is ham radio the focus of whatever they're heading out
to? No. Ham radio is the focus to those operators that are operating there. But the philosophy is that grab the attention of the kids who are doing the high adventure and say, hey, a lot of the kids will come over and say, while they're waiting in line at the zip line, what are you doing? And they'll say, hey, we're trying to contact people using a wire around the world. And the kids go, cool, where can I learn more? Well, why don't you come to the K2 BSA tent? Yes, it's a form of recruitment. It's a form of advertising. But on the other hand, remember, Jamboree is very, very intense schedule-wise. And there's no way, as somebody said yesterday, a staffer, you would have to be a world-class Olympic athlete to be able to see every activity that there is in the 10 days that Jamboree takes place. It's impossible.
How many people are there?
40,000, about 42,000, I think, were the numbers we finally heard, about 32,000 scouts and 10,000 leaders.
And most of the time, there's that many people there at once?
No.
Only for a jamboree.
Yeah.
Couple of interesting factoids.
Well, that's what I mean. For the week the jamboree is on, that city of 40,000 has got those people. It's not that much coming and going. People are there every day.
Yes, correct. That's a steady population. And you'll have day visitors that may amount to several thousand, but the nucleus is 42,000. And here's a couple of interesting factoids. Glen Jean, West Virginia, which you just saw on the map, which I think has an actual population within the municipality of just a few hundred, in this 1 week becomes the third largest municipality in the state of West Virginia. And the other factoid, which I had a tremendous time just wrapping my mind around, was that the various camps and how they're set out makes Jamboree officially the densest city in population per capita in the United States for the week that takes place, and that includes New York City.
Looks like fox hunting is a big deal.
Fox hunting is emphasized. Fox hunting is also part of the radio merit badge now. In the last revision, fox hunting was added as one of the four on-air options in obtaining the radio merit badge.
Is this ARDF type? It's on foot. I mean, nobody's driving around, so
yeah. Well,
do they do the multiple transmitters, and you go hunting several transmitters in one hunt?
I don't know.
Okay, I can see this is where they're advertising what frequency they're on. What time of day does the stations shut down? Because I was looking over at DX Summit, and I'll do a refresh here, but I think I was looking for K2 BSA, and it looks like things kind of wrapped up on 5:30 or so.
They do.
So they don't go all night.
Here's what happens.
Actually, today was the president, right?
No, yesterday, Monday, was the Monday, July 24th was the president. Today was a normal day. Today and tomorrow, Wednesday, the 26th, are normal operating days. Thursday is the last day that they're operating for the scouts, and K2BSA will go mostly in terms of how it is handling itself for scouts and everything at 4 p.m. Eastern or 2000 UTC, Thursday, July 27th.
So how big is the K2BSA staff?
About 42 volunteers. Now, you might say to yourself in your mind, holy crow, why is it so large? And remember that it's not just on-air operations. K2BSA is also offering the Radio Merit Badge. And there is a tent behind the operations tent that is divided into four rooms, if you will, or with partitions. And on the hour, every hour, the Radio Merit Badge is being offered there throughout the Jamboree. So if you come in any hour on the hour from 9 a.m. up to 1 p.m., you can complete the badge in 1 4-hour class.
Are they also doing license testing or license classes?
Yes. Are they doing that? No classes, but they are doing VE testing, yes.
Okay, that's great.
So you have to come fairly prepared to be able to take
a
test.
You do, because there will be no actual, the merit badge is being offered, but not, for example, licensing for technician class licensing. Although the VE sessions are there, and they offer, of course, testing for all three license classes, technician, general, and extra.
Are those 42 staff, are they pretty much every day, or does that get distributed
Every day you do get, during the course of the 10 days, you will get at least one day off. And in some instances, depending what your assignment is, you'll get maybe 2 days off, in which you get to do, you don't have to report to K2BSA. You can get out and do your own thing and enjoy other aspects of Jamboree.
And David, you wanted to do that, right?
Yeah, I had sent in an application and I was in process probably 18 months ago, and then I just couldn't work it out with my work, so I didn't follow through, and I opted out at some point, but I did want to go and help out. Someday I'll get there.
How hard is it to get
that job thing?
How hard is it to get a slot doing that?
Hard.
Yeah, there is a good vetting process. You know, I have a lot of credentials. You know, I've been a scoutmaster for 4 years. They were looking for people with a lot of experience. I have a lot of experience in that way. So, you know,
and now you're a TV star. So
yeah, I didn't include that then. That was before back in before that day.
It's important to point out, of the 42 people on staff, two or three slots are reserved for youth, scouts who are under the age of, was it, David? 18, 19?
Scouts are up till their 18th birthday.
Yeah, that's going to be my next question. Are there any actual scouts that are more or less full-time at the station?
They do. And they are licensed hams. The reality is, for somebody to be interested in this position, whether you're a scout or an adult, is that as much as it would be nice to be egalitarian and have technician class licensees, the breadth of what you do is such that you really need somebody with versatility and understanding. And so the application process does skew very heavily towards general and extra class licensees. And as David pointed out, with extensive experience, because you have to be proficient at a lot of different activities to be on staff, because you need to be able to fill in. Now, if you have a certain specialty, like, for example, there's somebody on staff who is an expert in high altitude balloon launches and using a transmitter to send out signals on APRS. That's his thing. But he also doubles and can do sidebands, CW, digipeters. The only separation of which I'm aware primarily are those that were assigned to the Radio Merit Badge, pretty much stick with the Merit Badge for the duration of the Jamboree. And you'll see some of those Radio Merit Badge people come over and help out with operations, but you seldom see the operations people, those assigned to operations or operating positions, going and teaching the badge.
Yeah, one of the things about scouting, and again, you have to be really selective. Working with youth, teaching things to youth, is really different than, you know, working in the business world and working with other adults. You have to understand how to interact with youth, how to get them motivated, how to show them things. You know, you talked about taking the radios out in the field as opposed to having everybody come to the site there, which is great. And, you know, what we find when we go out in the field and work amateur radio, when there's something like the zip line going on, but we're on the side, you know, 10% of the scouts will come and have some interest, and maybe 2% of them will stick around because they think, wow, this is really cool. It's not for everyone, and we get it, but having that exposure and getting them out there gets a couple of them in. And I was looking at the statistics from the 2013 Jamboree, 339 Radio Merit Badges, and I know they were hoping to get 400 this year. It's just a subset of who's out there, but offering it will spark some interest. And, you know, hopefully within a weeks or months, there'll be, you know, that many more scouts that have amateur radio license and will, you know, get involved in the hobby for life.
And I was very impressed this round at the methods of teaching for the Radio Merit Badge. When I did it in 2001, 2005, Jamborees, we were still using flip charts on easel boards. And now each of the four rooms that are in the tent that behind the main K2BSA tent where the Radio Merit Badge is taught, each has a large television set that's being used as a monitor. And the material has been placed not only in PowerPoint form, but PowerPoint form with animation, so that electronic theory shows that how modulation works, how digital coding works, how cell towers work as a form of radio, and all done with animation. Radio Merit Badge PowerPoint, by the way, has now been made available, and I believe it can be accessed through K2BSA's website, which is www.k2bsa.net.
Yeah, I found it out there somewhere. I'm not sure if I got it there or somewhere else, but it was in one of the references that I searched.
Yeah, there's the K2BSA site, but this is what I set up was their Jamboree.
Yeah, I think if you go to radio scouting. And Merit Badge, and I think it's in there somewhere.
Yeah, maybe second one down.
It's a very busy site. We're waiting for it to load. There we go.
Yes.
So go down a little bit further down. What training resources will be available? Keep going down. More. There you go. And that one right there.
Yeah, I see slide deck.
Yeah. No, the one that below that says the Jamboree Radio Merit Badge page. If you select that one, then that takes you to, I found this earlier in the week, that takes you to the page that has all of those PowerPoints that, you know, when you work a merit badge, you work requirements. There's a number of requirements you have to fulfill to earn a merit badge. And if you scroll down the page a little bit more, it shows you here's all the requirements 1 through 9 that you have to complete and fulfill to earn that merit badge. And I looked through some of these are really great. I'm going to definitely incorporate them into our merit badge program. We do that once a year.
Let's see, slide one of one. Oh, there's 12. Okay. Let's see. Let's earn a merit badge.
Yes. And thank you, of course, for the badge being shown correctly. I've seen scouts who earn the badge and don't know Morse code, put it in upside down. Right. So it comes out. Upside down. It's NSV. What's that? What's NSV?
Right.
Yeah. So that's very encouraging to see now the Radio Merit Badge, which used to take about 6 hours using easels and trying to do visualization. Now, through the animation, through this PowerPoint at K2BSA, can be achieved in 4 hours with 3 hours of class instruction and an hour of on-air experience, which is needed to fulfill the badge. And the format isn't the 4 hours. It runs as an hour and a half class, then an hour on the air, and a remaining 1.5 hours in order to get the badge. Excellent format redesign.
Yeah, that's great. Okay. We typically do it as a kind of a 2-day thing, you know, out in the field with the practical stuff. And then we do either a meeting or sometimes around the campfire, we'll work through some of those requirements. But this is great because it goes through each one of the different parts. You know, you see in the upper right-hand corner, but requirement 1C talks about the call signs in different areas. And, you know, you talk through, you know, what do these things mean? What do the locations mean? Why is KL Alaska, you know, and so on and so forth, because they don't have any idea. And somebody's going to ask, well, why are you, you're in California, but you're a zero, Mr. Goldenberg. And, you know, okay, well,
I keep asking that.
You explain that too. Well, maybe we'll settle down in Colorado after the kids move out. We'll see.
So just a magnificent opportunity, Gary. And I was really honored to go, but more importantly, as an alumnus myself, just so excited to see the the changes in technology, the applications of different modes, and the redesign of the radio merit badge to try and make it more relevant. One of the other things I liked is that, and I this is one of my big things I've been hopping up and down about for quite a while, is that to me, amateur radio is a glove-in-hand natural affinity with the overall STEM movement. And I'm glad to see that K2BSA is working with another program at the Jamboree called STEM Quest, and integrated a component of it into STEM Quest. So if a scout was going after STEM Quest as an achievement, I don't know if it's a merit badge, I don't think it is, but it's a type of program at the Jamboree. One of the places they have to stop by is K2BSA to learn about wireless technology applications.
So I got a question about the actual operation. Is it the eight stations, are they like going full out all day long?
Yes and no. Here's a typical day. And we'll start with in the morning. The scout leaders, the leaders stay in the staff camp, which is physically separated from where most of the scouts are. They stay at what are called base camps. And the leaders are up around between 6 and 6:30. They have breakfast around 7. They have to be at the K2BSA tent every morning at 7:30 to 8 a.m. for a daily briefing session. And that briefing session goes over the status of the equipment. For example, could discuss that a certain antenna came down overnight and needs repair. There's coax lines that need to be fixed. Maybe one of the transceivers has a loose coax connection or a bad capacitor in it. There's also a couple of guys on staff who are technically proficient that can take some equipment and work on it in an elementary fashion. And thanks to ICOM and their support, a couple of spares are kept so that if there's a failure of one, that they can put another one in. So
no maintenance shop, really?
There used to be. Now, this time around, there's still one, but it's not in the classic sense, because so much of today's equipment, much like automobiles, is done with such sophistication that, especially in a remote location like this, it's better just to have a couple of spares on hand in case you got to throw something in, as opposed to the old tube days where you could rip it apart and rewire, resolder, and put it back together.
We were talking about that in a previous program, weren't we, David?
Yep, we sure were. There's not a lot of that going on anymore.
Yeah. So the day starts at 7:30 to 8 with the briefing. Usually there's no transmitting, and that there may be some low-level receiving in the background. The CW guys, for example, may be picking up some morning CW traffic, but everybody else is listening to what is the day, who's coming that day, who's expected, if there are going to be any special visitors, what are the goals and objectives of the day. 8 o'clock to 9 o'clock is getting the stations ready, operating positions up and going, and then the first round of scouts come through at 9 a.m. And when the scouts come through, they come through in two capacities. They can be coming through as part of the fulfillment of the radio merit badge, in which they have set requirements, or they may be coming through out of curiosity to find out what is amateur radio about. And so it's just going to be a quick tour. The stations, as many operating positions as possible, go from 9 a.m. to roughly 5 p.m. Staff then is excused for the day at 5 p.m. And then at their option, they can operate themselves at K2BSA anytime from 5 p.m. until 7:30 the next morning. And so that's where you find some of the staff getting on doing K2BSA and really pursuing their own interests during the evening hours.
Yeah, handing out those QSL cards and making contact.
Right.
Is there like an all-hands activity every night with all the scouts together so they're not...
Yep.
So the station is really available for them?
I was going to jump in about that. You know, Boy Scout camp is a very regimented thing, right? Everybody gets up for flags in the morning, and then you have breakfast and probably multiple shifts if there's 40,000 people there having breakfast. And then you go through the classes or radio merit badges or the activities throughout the day or the morning. And then you get to lunchtime and everybody does lunch. And again, probably with 40,000 people, it's very staggered. And then you have the afternoon, and then usually evening, there's some kind of production, whether it be a big campfire or some activity or, you know, a snipe hunt or whatever that happens to be. And so I get the schedule that was kind of laid out there. It makes sense to me that you run from about 8 to 5, and then after hours, there's some time for the operators to get in there. And I think it'd be great if they'd open it up to scouts, but I know it's also hard because there is a lot of things for them to do and they want to keep them there. And then at some point they want to make sure they get to bed. Otherwise you'd have scouts, you know, ones that are really into it, trying to work DX all night long. And it doesn't help the program move forward.
Right.
I'm trying to think how that would be a bad thing, but maybe.
Well, you know, you have somebody, if somebody like me or some scout that's really into amateur radio that stays all up all night, you're going to be hangry in the morning and tired. And then when it comes to doing the things you wanted to do or supposed to do the next day, it makes it challenging.
Yeah, we do. You do get one or two kids that get the bug and get it so badly that they just hang out at K2BSA. And those are your ones who will get licensed to become future ops. And those are always fun kids to have. But even the leaders at K2BSA have to say to the kids, look, you just can't spend your whole jamboree here. Let's get out and
do some other stuff.
Do some other stuff and enjoy life. You know, this will still be here sometime. So don't worry about it.
So we talked about how it's a coveted thing for the adults to participate. And probably that is jamboree wide, not just K2BSA. Probably all of the adult activities are, you know, have competition. So what about for the kids? How hard is it for the average scout to get to the one that is in there in the how long is Boy Scouts? Is it 4 or 5 year activity?
Scouting starts, 10 and a half, as young as 10 and a half or 11, and goes until you're 18. And there's other programs. So the venture program is 14 to 21. So you could be in scouting if you start as a Cub Scout at 5 or 6 and go until you're 21.
Do Cub Scouts go to Jamboree?
No, Cub Scouts don't. Boy Scouts go.
So what I'm thinking is that the Jamboree is every 4 years. So there'll be two of them in the career of a scout while they're still a scout, and if they don't go into leadership,
depending on the cycle, that's correct. The
majority how likely is it any given scout can go?
I think it's easier for the scouts to get there than it is the leaders. It's there is a sacrifice of money for the for scouts. I mean, who and depending on the troop, there are different ways to raise money to attend. It's not cheap to get to Jamboree, particularly if you're not from the East Coast. I thought one of the cool things this time is that the summit is located next to at the town of Prince, West Virginia, where Amtrak has a passenger train 3 times a week, and they have they had a scout special that brought scouts to and from the Jamboree on the train.
Looking for Prince.
It's there someplace.
It's there somewhere.
It's probably closer. You probably zoomed out too far.
Yeah, you probably did. It's 9 miles from
The summit. There's Beckley.
Yeah, it's to your if you move to the right. But you can go up and look under Amtrak, and you'll find Prince. I see Hinton at the bottom. The railroad follows the New River, so go north of Hinton. Up through, there's Brooks, Sandstone, keep going up the river.
Look at all those twisty roads.
Oh, it is.
There's Prince right there.
Okay. Oh, right, tiny.
There it is. That's it. Oh, it is tiny. It's very tiny.
You sneeze and you're through it, and there's the railroad tracks. You can see them right there.
Yep. And that is the Amtrak stop for the Bechtel Summit Reserve.
Okay. Now we can see the New River well enough. I mean, that is a famous river.
Yep.
Yes, it is.
Wonder where they're
talking about going to Jamboree. I know from the scouts that go in our area, usually they spend a part of a week before, or a part of the week after doing kind of an East Coast tour because they're already over there and they already flew a plane. But I think the number is somewhere between $2,500 and $3,200 for the trip. So that's the big challenge is fundraising, and there are some camperships that, you know, people can get. But that's selling a lot of popcorn in front of the market on the weekends and knocking on a lot of doors and, you know, setting up Christmas trees and flags on holidays. And there's lots of different things we allow the scouts to do to earn money, but it really takes them to really put the money together and earn it. And but, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, and for leaders to be selected, not only do you have to be, have the right components to teach a merit badge, if that's one of the things you're going to do, or to be on staff, but you have to be in good physical shape. There's a lot of physical requirements to attend a jamboree: height, weight, medical condition, type of prescriptions you're on, ability to walk, run, perform physical exercise. There is a lot of criteria that beyond just knowledge that you have to have in order to be accepted as a leader.
Do scouts go in groups as part of a troop? Now, a whole troop is not going to go, but do big clusters of scouts from a troop go, or is it pretty much individual?
From our area, they set up what are called provisional troops. So from the Western Los Angeles County Council, they will put together, and I think it's more than one provisional troop of 20 or 30 individuals, and they bring scouts from all of the, I think there's 100 different troops in the Los Angeles County area. And, you know, they offer up the spaces, and until they fill the spaces, they scouts come in and they give them new, you know, so I have my, let's see over here, you know, I have my troop 22 patch for our troop number. They will give them whatever their provisional troop number is and rebadge their uniform so that they're all similar and together as that group for that week or 10 days or even 2 weeks that they're going to be out there for those trips.
Right. And there's so many troops, it's usually a four-digit number instead of the traditional two or three number. Yeah.
Yeah.
And the stations, when they're active on the air, do they get pileups?
Oh, gosh, yes. My goodness. It's pileup city. I remember very vividly, I was working 80-meter phone one night off duty when I was a staff, and just it was a absolute cacophony coming at me, and I heard one YL voice in the background, which, of course, is very, let's face it. We all like
the YL advantage, 10 dB advantage.
YL advantage, exactly. Yep. And I just said, well, the YL, everyone quiet, let the YL call. It turned out to be Larry Wolfgang's wife, who's also licensed and looking for him. I mean, that was just fortuitous. Yeah.
Well, you think about it, Gary, it's like activating, you know, an unknown DX entity for, you know, 10 days, and they send out QSL cards, and, you know, they'll indicate that you made the contact. So it's one of those things that, you know, if you have that attitude, and I know there are some operators out there that I don't want to talk to some kid and what have you, but a lot of people are going to chase after those cards in that contact and put them in the log.
The kid stays.
Yeah. The kids, that's fine. The kids will stay.
To a previous show, the kids stays.
Yes.
So I want to talk about three other things with you, Bill, but is there anything about the Boy Scouts thing that that you wish I had asked that we haven't talked about? Either of you guys.
Yeah. Again, just and we're going to break away from K2BSA for a second and just talk about the Jamboree, which is, I would call it the golden corral of opportunity and just a smorgasbord of things you can do.
I'm not sure that's it.
Well, as David pointed out, the Bechtel Summit Reserve is one of the four high adventure areas set aside by BSA Boy Scouts of America. Fort AP Hill, the previous location of the Jamboree, was not. That it is an active Army base. So the Boy Scout Jamboree was coexisting with an active Army base. And so, and because it was on the coastal plains, it was flat. So there really wasn't much high adventure to offer. So the whole Jamboree format has changed dramatically in the sense that, whereas at Fort AP Hill, I believe the last year they were there in 2010, they offered, which is the anniversary, they offered 100 of the 123 merit badges available. And most scouts, to put things in context for those who aren't familiar with scouting, a scout who will become an Eagle Scout has to earn 21 required badges And then most earn another 10 or 12 elective badges on average. So you'll never, once in a while, you'll see in the newspaper, there's some real go-getter who gets all the number. I think now the number of badges is 133, 136 badges.
135 is, I think, the number, yeah.
135.
Yeah.
But because the summit is geared towards high adventure, the number of merit badges offered has actually pulled back. And at this time, I think it's 80 badges rather than 100 that are being offered. But the point I want to make is we just went through the requirements to be selected as a staff member of K2BSA. Take those same types of criteria in whatever field of expertise is being offered and multiply that times 80 badges. And you are getting the cream of the cream in whatever field it is that is being offered. So you meet some pretty astounding people in areas you may not realize. And that makes Jamboree in itself very, very interesting also. Anybody who has an opportunity to do this, is it should go. Whether you're a scout, a scouter, an adult, you just want to go to, heck, I want to be a scout again just to go to, it's like grown-up camp. It's so much fun.
So I imagine every year someone brings up the suggestion, why don't we do this more than once every 4 years? Every 2 years, every year. Why not?
Probably. It's a big production. It's
too much hard, too hard to do.
Some of it's that, and some of it as pointed out. So, you know, the World Jamboree is coming up. And so that's, you know, that's another item. They're going to have the Venture Fest next year. And it is so many people coming together. And I know the scouts that are in our troop that went, we didn't have anybody go this year. Actually, that's not true. We had one crew member go this year. But for the scouts that went to the last one, they saved up for good part of 2.5 years to prepare for this. It takes a lot of time to get that kind of money together and get ready to go and make the time. So I think it makes it more special that they don't do it, you know, year after year after year. And I can't imagine right. what the effort would be. And you probably couldn't attract 40,000 if you did it every year. It would be some fraction of that.
Right, right.
So, the other thing, you asked, we won't fix it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The other thing, Gary, that you said what you didn't ask, I wanted to say, too, that in addition to their very generous support directly at K2BSA, ICOM has provided and maintains the repeaters at the Bechtel Summit.
Yeah, I was going to ask about that. You and a couple other people in the pictures I saw from your website had handy talkies on. Congratulations. Good job.
Yeah, thank you.
Did anybody use them?
Yes, we actually did. And the other thing is, and I commend K2BSA for doing this, they're trying to make access available across all, if you, for lack of a better term, platforms into and out of K2BSA, and especially for technicians that so they have an opportunity too. We've talked an awful lot about HF type of modes, but there are Echolink and IRLP links in and out of the Jamboree. There's a D-Star Digipeater up there, APRS, and then Analog FM, all of which donated by and maintained by ICOM.
I was going to look for their webpage because it had shown a bunch of repeater frequencies and things, but I'm not sure where that is.
And ICOM's a big supporter. They actually, they have a bunch of Pelican boxes that they send all over the U.S. For different scouting events that they loan out on a regular basis. And it's good equipment. It used to be 7100s, and now they're rolling out 7300s. I'm hoping when I go to Philmont tomorrow on Thursday, I think through the end of this week, they're running at the Walmart, the Tooth of Time, which is the store there. They're running a K2BSA station as well, and I don't know what number they're using for this particular week, but they're running a whole radio program there, and I'm hoping to make some contests.
K5R or K5K, I think.
Yeah,
it is.
I don't remember something what the number is.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, and Gary, one more thing too. You said things that you didn't ask. There's a nightly net that meets. And the thing to keep in mind is not all hams are at K2BSA. There's probably another easily 100 to 150 licensed hams that may be coming to Jamboree doing other assignments or that have nothing to do. For example, yesterday morning, I checked in on Echolink. It's a conference. It's called BSA 365, I think it is. You can look it up on Echolink or use the Echolink app on your iPhone. show and tell. I gave a call out, and a instructor at the rifle range came back to me. Had nothing to do with K2BSA, but he was monitoring the Echolink station repeater up there, which I think is great. And the nightly net, which takes place every night except the night they have what are called the arena shows. For example, last night, the president's visit constitutes an arena show. We'll have check-ins anywhere from 40 to 80 people starting at 7 o'clock at night. Used to be when it was held at Fort E.P. Hill, because there's not other high adventures to do, there would often be check-ins around upwards of 100.
Yeah, here's comment on the Facebook page. Someone was able to contact him on Echolink. So folks around the arena or around the whole event chat with each other through the repeater.
Well, they can sort of randomly. You can do. I think there's a lot. There's actually a lot of simplex that takes place. I think base camp to base camp, and because the repeater is fairly active.
And the net you were talking about, that's on the repeater. Is it for the local activity?
Yeah, it's a local net. In other words, it's meant to be a Jamboree resident, if you will, net once a night, just to kind of check on things and have people check in. But what's astounding is, as I said, the number of hams who come to Jamboree who have nothing to do with K2BSA, they'll stop by, they'll introduce themselves, they'll ask if they, and by the way, they can also come and operate at night during off hours too. They can put a request in and say, I've been assigned to, in fact, that other gentleman, rifle shooting, but may I come in one night after hours and maybe get a 1 hour slot to try a hand? Absolutely. so they get access to it also.
All right. So John, elsewhere in the world,
yes,
just got done with field day.
Yes.
And we produced our field day tour video with our mutual friend, Carl Bowman, W4CHX. He and I drove around.
I heard you and Carl had a good time this year at field day.
We had a great time, and you have a very small cameo appearance in that program.
Do tell.
Well, we were trying to talk to you on a DMR. Oh. And so I got a snippet of that on video.
I remember, and I was going through a fringe area. So
yeah,
and the frustration we both had trying to make contact on DMR. Yes.
Yep. Well, we were both at fringes of repeaters we weren't familiar with, so we didn't know quite where to go to get good solid coverage. But I got a few seconds of you talking to Carl.
Well, thank you.
But you were doing a tour of your own.
I am, and. For those who aren't familiar with field day, it's general practice among ARRL field personnel. By that, I mean directors, vice directors, and section managers, and also some other officers, such as section emergency coordinators, to get out and visit field day sites on behalf of ARRL. It is the largest exercise sponsored by ARRL each year, with approximately 35,000 participants in 1,500 station locations. By the way, not only just the U.S., but also Canada. And our good friends in the north of RAC, Radio Amateurs of Canada, also get on to do that. So it's a flag waving. But it's, to me, it's my absolute favorite day of the year. I just relish field day. I'm like a little kid on Christmas morning. I love to go from location to location, meet people, see what they have just a lot of fun and check in. And to give you an example, I represent the Roanoke Division of ARRL, which consists of four states, Virginia, West Virginia, North Carolina, and South Carolina. There are 40,000 hams in that those four states. There are about 13,000 ARRL members. 150 field day locations, and they all want to see you Saturday afternoon between 2 p.m. and 4 p.m. So you have to be a little judicious on how you use your time.
Yeah.
But
we had some folks that were only going to be operating on Saturday, so we had to make sure we caught those guys.
We have that too. And I've in my years, Gary knows that prior to my current position, I served 4 years as the North Carolina section manager. There's been many a Sunday morning that I have pulled up to a specified location only to find it empty.
They're gone.
Yeah. And for a variety of reasons, many of them storm related. This year, where I travel, and I traveled coastal southeastern North Carolina and coastal South Carolina, there was no rain on Saturday afternoon. And I found that most of the clubs were pretty excited because it was the first time in 5 years that they had not had a Saturday afternoon storm. And as a consequence, their score totals went up. Whatever category and class they had. So it had been a long time since they had done that. That was one thing I had. The other is I had just an absolutely delightful visit with the Grand Strand Amateur Radio Club in Myrtle Beach, South Carolina. Their PIO, Gordon Mooneyham, W4EGM, has a small publishing company of his own. They were having quite the field day festivity when it came to food. Gordon has just released in the last year two paperbacks that he has published. One is Dining Car Recipes from the Atlantic Coastline Railroad. The other is Dining Car Recipes from the Southern Railway, both of which ran through the Roanoke Division. And both, one is now CSX, the other is Norfolk Southern. And he collected these recipes. These are about 100-page books each, and they were trying them out. So the eating was mighty good.
So they were cooking those recipes.
They were cooking.
Are they those still recipes done on the trains, or are they? Is that just lost to history?
That's lost to history. But thankfully, Gordon went through with some people and researched a lot of this stuff and found some really crackerjack recipes that. From yesteryear that are still mighty tasty today.
So that was fun.
I got to try some, and believe me, it was well worth it. And that's the fun thing too, right?
I went with the wrong guy.
Well, the other thing is, it's so much fun. I hope you found this out too, Gary and David, for you, that when you go to these places and you come as a visitor, that a lot of places really roll out the red carpet for you. And it's really nice to be accepted and get the $5 tour and to see a lot of innovation. That's the thing I enjoy particularly is the I tell folks who don't understand what ham radio is, and then I explain field day is we are the MacGyvers of communication. And so field day is a chance for us to take what we have in our hand and to make amateur radio work. And that is what is so much fun, to see the improvising that's going on, that it remains successful. Can you get a signal out and be received? The answer is yes. Even though you see some strange looking combinations of antennas and situations.
Yep. You got a show to watch then, Bill.
I do have a show to watch.
You got to watch me and Carl get out there. We saw 10 different field day sites. So how many did you get to?
I got to 11 over the course of Saturday and Sunday.
You didn't have a film crew with you.
I didn't have a film crew.
Which reminds me, back to the Boy Scout thing. You're talking about all these activities that went outside the tents for K2BSA. Where's the documentation? You're a PR guy, right?
Yeah.
You and I have both been heavy duty into the PR stuff. And you know, to do PR, you need documentation. You need pictures. You need video. You need editing. Where is that?
I'm not on staff this year. Good question.
Next time.
Okay, you movie merit badge scouts.
Yeah. But just to let David know and to you all that across from K2BSA, Boys Life Magazine sponsored 8 merit badges in a tent across the road from K2BSA. One of those 8 was movie making. So we probably should have stopped there and asked that same question, Gary.
Should have hauled them on over.
Yeah,
absolutely.
But there's so much activity going on that they probably had no lack of things of people doing stuff
to document it. David's right. I mean, it's like drinking from a fire hose. There's just so much you can do.
So we need our own. We need our own ham radio documentarians.
You do. You're not going to get it documented otherwise. Yeah. It's overstimulation in a good sense. But you just can't cover everything because it's so intense for the time that you're there.
And I talked to Jim, the leader of the ham radio stuff, about coming, because I don't live that far away. It's like a 4 or 5 hour drive for me. Mm-hmm. But I looked at the media requirements, and there's only two opportunities to get in and out a day for media, very controlled. And there didn't appear to be a way for me to come in specifically to document K2BSA as ham radio now. And I don't know if we spent more time and started earlier, if we could wangle something special, but it just looked like it was going to be too difficult to do. So coming in from the outside, I think you got to be inside and, you know, have the cameras and the mics.
You probably got to spin it less media and more documentary filmmaking.
Yeah, I would agree with David on that. Yes.
And those are probably the opportunities to make it there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Next topic, totally divorced from what we've been talking about so far, but it's still within your bailiwick now as a assistant section manager. We haven't heard very much.
Vice Director, as Carl calls me.
Hang on just a second. Okay, there we go. The ARRL Roanoke Division Vice Director.
Hey, thank you. Can
read your title. There we go. Put it my title.
All right.
But I didn't want to switch the picture. I wanted to keep that picture. The Parity Act. We've talked about it before. And it has gone through a number of iterations. And I sent email recently to Chris Imlay and Mike Lysenko. They were on 2 years ago on Ham Radio Now talking about the Parity Act as nothing had happened with it, and we were beating on doors, and at every ham fest we were getting hams to sign petitions and letters to their congressmen. So as it currently stands, last year's expired. It died of inaction. It had passed the House, and it was being held up by one senator from Florida, Bill Nelson. So it died. So this year, it immediately passed the House, just in a flash. And it is now at the Senate. It's been introduced at the Senate. It is going to go to a committee someplace. What do you know more about that than I do at this point? That's all I know. Where does it stand, and what do hams need to do about it?
Hams need to get in touch with their respective senators now. That's where the action is. And we had a great campaign over the last 2 years, both in the previous session of Congress and in the current session of Congress, where the identical act was reintroduced, HR 555 on the House side.
Which means there's a timer attached to it.
Yeah.
555. It's a very famous timer chip.
I got the joke.
Yeah. All right.
You're a financial guy, not an engineer.
Yeah, I know. Okay. So on the Senate side, it's 1634. There are so many numbers swirling in my head right now. 1635?
I don't remember. Now, is Bill Nelson still opposed? He's one of the senators from Florida.
He is. He has reservations. I don't want to go so strongly as to say oppose. He has reservations, and the crux of the argument is that the National Homeowners Association (CAI) Communities Associations Incorporated has come to an agreement with ARRL and
the hammered out compromise language, which a lot of hams say gave away the store. They're wrong. And I'm not sure what the homeowners associations think about it.
Well, I for those who think that giving away the store, I respectfully have to disagree, because no successful piece of law ever gets to become law without compromise. And would you rather have 70% of something as opposed to 100% of nothing?
Yeah.
And So I'm sorry for their disagreement. I've seen the counter arguments. I understand the rationale. I notice I say understand. Yeah. I don't accept that that rationale.
I live in a homeowners association area, although I got permission to put up antennas. But if I hadn't, I would love to have what the current agreement holds, to be able to go to my board and say, let's talk. I would love to have that.
Well, the other thing is nobody talks about this angle, about what the law is supposed to achieve. And that is, I hear over and over again about the ham who was the fool who entered into a neighborhood or subdivision with a homeowners association, knowingly going in, signing the contract for the homeowners association, and then pleading they want to put up an antenna. Well, there's two ways you can handle that. You could try and negotiate before saying my purchase within this is contingent upon homeowners association permitting me to put up a tower. That is more common than you think. I hear that. Yeah. And then those who
this was a new development. This uh-huh. house was about to be built. And so mm-hmm. the homeowners association at that time was the builder. And mm-hmm. well, they were selling every house they built. They were still incented to work a deal,
but probably way easier to deal with them than it would have been with all of the neighbors in the community that
once you get your local Gestapo neighborhood association guy, that there always seems to be one.
right
But what the I don't hear people, and I have to remind people that, what do you do with the existing homeowner who either, for example, who may not be hams themselves, but has a child who may develop an interest in late elementary school, middle school, or high school to become an amateur radio operator?
Yeah, and there's a dozen or so good arguments mm-hmm. To counter the idea of you signed a contract, deal with it.
That's exactly my point. We have circumstances which, in other words, somebody could. Or the person who's got to move in with an elderly parent to become a caretaker who may be a ham.
Well, I've heard an interesting conspiracy theory recently about those, you signed the contract, deal with it. You know who those people are? They are people that have towers and kilowatt amplifiers and don't want you to be competition for the DX they want to work. they got their nickel's worth, and they don't want you to have it. They won't close the door on the way out. So I don't know if any of that's true, but... That's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
You can stick to that one. I'm not sure I can buy that. Anyway, you asked the opposition. The opposition is, while the National Association has bought off on the agreement, it appears that not necessarily the state HOA Advocacy Association has bought off.
Yeah.
And that's where the rub lies. So you asked at the top of this conversational subject, what can hams do? And the answer is reach out to their U.S. senators. There's two for every state, and just tell them to please lend their support to this in national interest.
Yeah. So I'll talk to if Chris and Mike are able to come on the show again and talk to me. I'll ask them more direct questions, things like that. But I'm just wondering, in today's political climate, all we hear in national news is inaction and fighting. Well, the House got through very quickly with this more or less non-controversial bill. So I wonder if the Senate can, or if the political climate really has an effect, or if that's just because we're constantly bombarded with it in the news. We think, well, nothing ever is going to get through. Something like this could, but I don't know how.
Well, something like this could. It's a relatively speaking, innocuous bill. We'd like to think it's a bit of a mom and apple pie type of bill. I'm on a campaign myself right now that remind people that what I'm calling the last link. And what I mean by that is, what do you do in a large scale disaster, whatever the reason, be it natural or man-made, and your neighborhood is cut off from landline service, cellular service, internet, and you've got a diabetic across the street, You have another neighbor who's had a snake bite. You've had another one who's had a tree fall down and broken
a leg. I don't
want
to live in his neighborhood. It's a terrible things happen there.
It's an awful neighborhood in which to be. We hope there's a ham who can get the word out for him.
Yeah.
And that's,
you know, that, you know, our audience is all hams, right?
Oh, yeah. I know that. I know. I'm preaching in the choir.
And, you know, in that case, they're going to all line up at his front door, and he's going to put his antenna up temporarily. And then after the disaster is over, they're going to send him a bill for all of the violations that he incurred.
That, David, thank you. That, when I speak to legislators and I speak to groups, a major point I make is you cannot make an argument require that you can put up an antenna when a crisis takes place. Because remember the old musician's joke, how do you get to Carnegie Hall? Practice, practice, practice. What makes an amateur radio operator successful? Practice, practice, practice. You've got to be able to have drills. I'm a little bit out of step. The way that the legislation's written, what I'm looking for on my desk, by the way, is I have a draft copy somewhere around here of a little pamphlet I've been designing that talks about the last link, I call it, which is neighborhood communications that you want. If I find it before the end of the broadcast, I'll show the quick copy. It hasn't been approved. It's just something I'm doing on my own. But I this argument that, well, of course an emergency will let you put up an antenna, that's not the time you want us to do that.
Yep. Well, no one's gonna have an antenna. No one's gonna have a ham license. No one's gonna know how.
That's right. You can't ask a symphony orchestra to perform only on the night of their concert. Mm-hmm. In the same way, you cannot ask an amateur radio operator to do something in your behalf when the crisis is underway.
Yeah.
That gets me really riled when I hear that.
So I'll put up David's title, and you can look at the bottom and notice it is, in addition to being a Boy Scout leader, he is also an EC.
Right.
So he's on board here.
Yeah, right.
We live in that world, although I don't have a homeowners association, so I'll put up as many antennas, and I only hear from my mom who lives over the garage about them. And I tell her, thanks, I'm the landlord, and we'll just keep putting them up as we want to.
Okay. So the last thing I wanted to ask you about is we can put on one of your old hats that's, you know, still hanging up in the closet someplace, your PR hat.
Okay.
Because ARRL's media and public relations guy, Sean Kutzko, KX9X, has just announced his
resignation.
I was going to say retirement, but he's a little too young for that. He's going someplace else. I don't know what there is to say about that other than, you know, good luck, Sean, wherever you're going next. And there's your pamphlet.
It is. This is the black and white. This is draft. And this is not a sanctioned ARRL piece. What I'm showing is... this is something that's designed for homeowners association to say, why is neighborhood communications vital? And why having an amateur radio operator in your neighborhood is as vital as it is as having a doctor, a nurse, somebody in EMS, a policeman, a fireman, a public service individual that can help you in a time of crisis. And having a wire in the backyard, is that a small price to pay for having the security of knowing that you have communications access when needed? I don't think it's too big a price to pay.
So that you are designing to go to homeowners associations or the state level?
It will be
state level,
right?
Folks.
Well, that type of thing. And this is just me. This is just an effort I'm undertaking right now. And I've got it's a work in progress. I've got. Where was he? This is the other version I have. Yeah, I had on there on the inside showing some tornadoes and things in different ways. I also tell people, too, that communications is so critical. And this goes back to the, as you both probably know, it was never officially adopted that FRS, Family Radio Service Channel Number 1, was to be designated in emergencies. And, of course, the other informal one, that CB Channel Number 9, is designated.
Yeah, that is official, as official as something that gets no enforcement can be.
Right. And monitoring, by the way, in an emergency. That's the other thing. So the only one of those three methods, FRS, CB, and amateur radio, which one has the demonstrated track record of getting through? And the answer is because of its amateur radio. That's right. So anyway, I think getting back to the PR thing, Gary, and you asking about Sean, and I'm assuming we're going down that road as to what the future might be.
Yeah. Do you think that the ARRL's PR effort has been as good as it ought to be? Do you think they get enough resources? Do you think that they pay enough attention to it, or too much lip service, or do they really go out as hard as you think that they should and could?
I think there's been, and I'm going to speak as Bill Morine right now, in my personal opinion. I'm not going to speak as an ARRL board member. I personally have been disappointed in the last couple of years that there's been not so much a movement to social media. I'm very much in support of social media, but I believe it's been at the expense of what has been traditional media, meaning PR as we knew it up to about 5 years ago, the emphasis on
newspapers, TV stations, radio stations.
You got it. And when I see metrics coming out that certain podcasts are pulling 35,000 to 70,000, those are impressive numbers. I'm not going to deny that. And those are engaged individuals.
We don't get that number, do we, David?
Not yet.
Not yet, yeah. But it's coming.
Yeah, we're working. It's sure. It's a work in progress. Yeah. We're the trend is upward. Mm-hmm. But I remember so much that when I was on the public relations committee and we would do analyses of newspaper coverage coming out of field day, we could use a honored formula, and that we were getting newspaper exposure to an estimated 8 million readers. And yes, maybe of 8 million readers, only 1% would be truly engaged. Well, now we're back at the 80,000 number that you get with your podcast. But in that 1%, you get people of the general public. You get government officials, legislators, people who may not necessarily be following podcasts. I am hoping that ARRL will get back to a balance between social media and traditional media.
Okay, so I'm going to take from that comment that you're old.
Well, yes, and I've been accused of being old. But I, for one, am very and if somebody who is
can
active
I reach,
in social
can I, can
media,
I reach all the way through your frame, David, and just poke him a little bit?
No way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. I'm just pulling your leg.
But you know, social media to me does not reach outside spheres of influence at this stage. And I think traditional media has a better opportunity to perhaps reach influential parties who could be beneficial to amateur radio. Yeah. Maybe it's the touchstone. Maybe it's where they get exposed, and then if they wish to delve deeper, get to the social media level. I mean, social media to me is the inner circle, and then traditional media is the outer circle. We still need those outer circle influencers, just as we need the inner circle ones. Yeah. And
but maybe
I think
we haven't learned how to effectively use social media as well. There's only one person I can think of that has effectively leveraged social media to great advantage. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure that that's a formula that can be replicated by very many other people. When I was talking to folks at Field Day Sites, doing my media thing at the Field Day Sites on that tour, one of the questions I asked was about their outreach, their media outreach, and I asked about social media, and they said, "Well, we do a great job on social media. We put it on our website." Hams don't understand the concept of utilizing social media to reach out beyond the ham community.
I agree. Now let me, and I'm the first to say this. I mean, first to come to the forefront. I think one of the things that needs to be done better across all ham radio media outlets is that we coalesce on common hashtags and reference points so that we can cross pollinate and reinforce one another. And the standardization of those, I think, is still somewhat elusive at this stage. And I'd like to see in 2017 and 18 an agreement among different ham radio outlets, the big ones too, QST, CQ, and of course the podcasts and the ones that are somewhat in between social media and what we're doing now. I mean, like webcasting, that we all agree that these are touchstones that we can gravitate towards so that we can improve our brand and get the general public to have a better understanding and of who we are and what we do.
So as a division vice director and someone who sits in at least at the board meetings, with Sean leaving, the league has been retrenching financially as hard as they can because they, you know, the stories that I hear are that, you know, money's not great up there at this point. They've been spending more than they've been taking in, and they have to not do that because they can't print money. But do you expect that is a position that will be filled, and will it be taken seriously, or is Sean the last great media and PR guy for a while?
Well, let me clarify some things. I think I would not say the finances are as dire as perhaps may be portrayed, but there's no question that there needs to be some better stewardship. Tom Gallagher, the new CEO of ARRL, of whom I'm a great fan, brings a great perspective for the 21st century of how to really wed revenues with expenses and make things productive. He has a very interesting background in the sense that he himself is not a great contester. He's not a great DXer. Not that he's not capable. These are just spheres within amateur radio that have not been of great interest to him. It doesn't mean he doesn't appreciate them. It's just that they're not passions of his. And I think it gives him a very healthy, dispassionate look as to what ARRL needs to look at in order to modify itself and ensure that it has a very healthy future, both financially, in terms of programs, and in terms of membership. Now, that said, Sean's resignation came so close to the board that I don't have an answer to share with you this evening as to what that direction is going to be. Sean and the league did hire a recent assistant, Michelle, can't recall Michelle's last name, whose purpose is to focus on social media at the league, and she is doing that at this time.
Okay, and David is sending me a message. You got to go.
I need to wrap pretty soon.
Okay.
I hate to go because I'm enjoying it.
I think we're pretty close to being done. We'll keep asking this question as time goes by.
Please do keep asking, because ARRL is a member organization. There's a lot of stuff swirling around about it and the future. I feel good, and that's just not smoke. I really, really feel good about the future of the league. But the league has got to do some modification to make itself relevant going forward in the 21st century. Yeah. And others are underway.
I want to give you some ammunition and maybe, you know, see down the road, and hopefully not too far down the road, what the league might be doing in terms of the media that reaches hams and not necessarily the general public. And you can say, how come Gary's got a TV studio and ARRL headquarters doesn't?
Well, that's it. That's a great question. It really is.
Yeah. And, I mean, Sean was starting to do some interviews and some things, but they're just one-offs on YouTube without a lot of ballyhoo behind them.
I think they're doing
the doctor show as an audio podcast. Yeah. They do the audio news and the e-newsletter. And I think that's and some equipment reviews that are sort of QST centric. And that's the new media that's coming out of the headquarters, unless I'm missing something.
Well, I think you are missing some things in there. There's some developments coming down the road, and I'm not being coy. It's just that a lot of this is so new with Sean's resignation just announced last week that it hasn't been thought through yet. So,
well, I was talking to Alan Pitts about doing this, so that's a while ago.
Okay.
Alan Pitts was the media director before Sean, and I think Sean's been there, what, about 5 years, so.
I don't think he's been that. He's been at ARRL a long time, but not in the capacity of media and PR. I think it's maybe closer to 3 years.
That's true, because I would have been doing this show while Alan was still doing it, and we're a little over 5 years old. So
yeah.
So he may have been beating us for something like this, and they just said no, we can't do it, or we don't want to do it.
Mm-hmm. Well, so. I think I'm excited because I think. And a lot of people are very upset about Sean's leaving. And so I think there's going to be a period of introspection as to what direction in which ARRL needs to go relative to PR. And let's collectively put on our calendars to maybe have a chat 6 months from now when things will be a little clearer and we can decide what would be, I can share with you what are some of those efforts going forward. And we'll plug them in and see what happens.
Good deal. Yeah. So we got a couple of other shows here that we've lined up to do.
Yep.
Based on things we talked about here. All right. Bill Morine, thank you very much for coming by and talking to us about Boy Scouts and stuff.
David, okay, since I just came from Jamboree.
Let's live long. Exactly. Live long and prosper.
No, it's not this.
Yeah.
Okay. I think I got it.
All right.
So you are Bill Morine, N2COP, and this guy in the middle of the screen.
And again, for the record, my call sign, it was original issue when I upgraded from technician to general in 1981. I am non-law enforcement. And for that New York City detective in Brooklyn who called me to ask if my call sign is available because was I losing interest in the hobby or was I terminally ill?
No, you're not.
I'm not.
Yep.
I like my call and I'm keeping it.
How many tickets has your license plate gotten you out of?
Well, you know, it's a funny thing you say that because I do have it on the back of my car. I never pretend to be a law enforcement official. I'm not. But I've been blessed. I think I have a wooden screen. Let me knock on it. I have not had a ticket since I've had it on my plates. Okay. Let's hope this stays that way.
Here in the middle of the screen.
And I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
I'm Bill Morine, N2COP.
Scoutmaster EC.
Scoutmaster Goldenberg.
And co-host of Ham Radio Now. I am Gary Pearce, KN4AQ. That is it for the show. If you enjoy the programs and stuff like that, let's see, where have I got? Where?
Somewhere over here.
There
not
he
that
is.
That one, yeah.
This thing is not as responsive as I think it ought to be. HamRadioNow.tv if you enjoy the programs and want to help us out financially. And make everything go away. Bill, you know how we finish the show, don't you?
Boy, it's been so long since you've invited me on that I need a refresher.
Okay, we will go from screen right to screen left.
All right. Well, I'm still seeing just David in two screens. I haven't got the whole thing. And is it so long until tomorrow? No, that was Lowell Thomas.
It's not Happy Trails.
I bet he'll pick it up.
He'll pick it up. Bill, we're going to give you the last word.
All right. Thank you.
And David and I will do the
before I do, I do want to thank both of you, David and Gary, for the opportunity to let me come on.
Yeah. Compared to the last show we did, David, I think we maintained some focus here.
Yes, we did.
So I feel better about this.
Yes, we did.
I will do the third to the last. David will do the penultimate word. And
right.
Bill will give you the last word. Here
All
we
right.
go.
I like that. SAT word.
Over.
And.
Out. Thanks, Came back Gary. To me. Thanks, guys.
Are you still banned from shortwave radio?
Banned? Oh, yes. I'm not banned. I've decided to take a hiatus from
you appeared
31 meters.
You appeared on Ham Radio Now some time ago. And you had been a regular guest on a shortwave broadcast that I won't mention, but his initials are Ted Randall. Right. And he heard you on this show, and if I've got my story straight, and I'm getting you in as much trouble as I can, said, well, right. then you're not welcome on the QSO radio show anymore.
Yes.
You've been on there fairly regularly.
Which puzzled me because, yes, I was a regular on there, and I don't recall signing the exclusivity contract.
And by the way, we're still on Facebook Live.
Okay, that's
and we're
fine.
Still recording. So,
you know, I have a lot of respect for Ted, but I don't quite understand why he felt that I didn't share anything. I think with you that I deprived of from him. He runs a great show. I fully believe in shortwave and in the QSO show. I just was sorry that something went awry there, and I just can't quite figure out what it is, and I've never gotten quite the explanation. But no, I have not reappeared on his show.
Okay, so now that we've got you back on Skype, apparently I owe you to keep getting you on Ham Radio Now, at least.
It is, and I hope my Skype account doesn't get hacked again. That was just a weird thing. I was not real happy when that happened.
Well, I'd set up another one.
That's what I'm going to do. And if you have any tips on what I can do to kind of keep my information somewhat sacred on Skype, I would appreciate that.
You remember that password? I created a Skype account for Bill to be able to come in here and do it quickly. Remember that password you had so much trouble with?
Yeah.
That's how.
I know, but I had it through a bundled product I had actually purchased with Microsoft, because I had also used Skype for domestic international calling.
Yeah.
The audio fidelity on Skype, I think, is fantastic. Yep. Video depends on what the situation is for bandwidth. I find audio calls on Skype when I'm overseas to just be a miraculous quality. Really, really good.
Yep. And that microphone that David had is for Skype anyway. It's just as good sounding as this PR40 I'm talking into. Mm-hmm. And it is $70.
Yeah.
It's the Audio Technica ATR 2100. It has an XLR output, but it's also got a USB output, and it's got a headphone jack, and it becomes a full sound card. So if you're talking to somebody, you can have really good sounding audio. If you're, say, a guest on a Ham Radio Now show on a regular basis,
yes.
and you want,
yes.
although you're sounding fine, the headset sounds yeah. fine, but you could sound yeah. a little better. With a better mic, and it becomes a full sound card.
That's why I rely on you for editing.
$70. I don't edit.
All right, Gary, let's pull the plug on this baby. And again, thank you for letting me join you this evening. I hope you and your viewership enjoy the comments and the perspectives that we can offer.
I think we learned a lot.
I like that.
Oh, so now you're seeing my shot.
Shoulder.
Now you're seeing my shot.
I like that.
You're having trouble seeing what I was sending you. Yeah, this is one of my favorite shots.
All right.
So, okay.
All right. The salute. And again, and I'm a big fan of the old, Lowell Thomas and the Lowell Thomas movie reels. Remember those?
You're one of those guys that has to do the Vulcan thing. And you have to.
Well, here I can do it with my other hand actually pretty easily.
I think I can do it with both. There we go. I could be a Vulcan.
What a show! No, Vulcan squared with that.
Yeah. Live
Absolutely.
Long. Live really long and right. prosper like crazy.
Since my day job is a financial planner, please do prosper. All right. Take care, Gary. Good catching up with you.
All right. See ya. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Okay, Facebook, it's just you and me. And titles, which sort of worked and then sort of didn't. All right. But it's going to make it easier for me to jam this thing through the editor because I won't have to put titles in, just fade up. Prayed out at the end, and and I will put in post-production the ARVN boom thing. You, for those of you watching this on YouTube, you already saw it, but that was added in editing. But that's about all the editing that I've got to do. So I'm going to be a happy guy. Thank you, Bill. Thank you, David. See you guys. Oh, I've lost the switch. It's here somewhere.